Hi, it's me, Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut. SpaceX just experienced the first failure of landing a Falcon 9 in almost 2.5 years. We've gotten so used to them just nailing these first stage landings that we forget that they've actually failed ever. The last time the Falcon 9 itself failed was June 15th, 2016 on the Eutelsat 117 mission. But they also had, of course, the center stage of the Falcon Heavy failed to land. But this is the first time we've seen a landing failure in a long time. Now, the important thing is, of course, this mission was actually successful because this was CRS-16, which is a resupply mission for the International Space Station for NASA. And the primary mission, getting that into orbit and getting it on its way to the International Space Station, is and still has been successful. So that's the important part before we dive into this. Don't forget that. That's the primary mission. Now, before we go any further, let's explain how this is supposed to happen, what systems control the Falcon 9 to get it down onto the ground safely, and then we're going to dive into what exactly went wrong. So this is a Falcon 9 rocket, a really high detailed model from buzzspacemodels.com. Now, you'll notice, of course, after a good 2.5 minutes or so of burning, the first stage is about down to 30% fuel left, and it lets go of the second stage. So the second stage, fully fueled, boop, pops off into orbit and sends this Dragon capsule up to the International Space Station. That's how rockets just generally work. The first stage typically depletes itself and falls into the ocean and crashes forever, going bye-bye. SpaceX, though, has different plans, and they've done this successfully so many times we forget how hard it actually is. But here's what happens. So this is a booster that's approximately 45 meters tall, around 150 feet tall. And what it does at first is it does a flip maneuver using some cold nitrogen gas thrusters in the inner stage of the vehicle. Then it lights 3 of its 9 Merlin engines and performs a boost back burn, meaning it cancels out its horizontal velocity and begins to point itself back towards its landing pad. In this case, it was LZ-1 at Cape Canaveral Air Force Station. Then after it does that boost back burn, it begins to open up its grid fins. And it has 4 of these things on the inner stage. And what these are, they're titanium grid fins. They've used titanium on these Block 5 boosters. That's the newest variant of the Falcon 9. And these grid fins open up like this, and the camera you see is looking from on the interstage, looking down the rocket, and you can see a pair of them opened up. They pop out, and then what happens is the grid fins still don't really do much in the vacuum of space, so those cold nitrogen gas thrusters still continue to do their thing. And then, once it gets near the atmosphere, as it approaches the atmosphere, the vehicle does what's called a re-entry burn, or an entry burn. And it lights up 3 of those 9 Merlin engines again, and it slows itself down about halfway before it really hits the thick part of the atmosphere. This is so that the atmosphere doesn't tear the vehicle apart, because that'd be bad. And so then the vehicle's now beginning to enter thicker and thicker and thicker atmosphere, and that's when these grid fins have more and more control. And really quickly, we can see in the video that as it's beginning to use those grid fins more and more, it starts to wobble and oscillate out of control pretty violently. And they cut the feed, supposedly by accident, but SpaceX isn't too ashamed to show their failures. So, of course, within an hour, Elon gave us the full cut. And here's a shot from my friend Dos Valdez, who is out there on the Cape. He was live streaming this on Twitch on his Kerbal Space Academy, K-Space Academy page. So he actually was watching this live along with, again, thousands of people who tune in and get to witness these down in Florida. I wish I was down there for this one. But yes, he actually has footage of it, and you can see it doing this roll here, and it's amazing that the vehicle was still able to control itself. I mean, look at, even though it looks like it's going completely out of control, it gets itself under control pretty darn quickly. This is amazing. This is impressive. It's amazing that even though the grid fins failed, the vehicle was still able to control itself to the same degree. So great footage from Dos Valdez. Make sure you check him out on K-Space Academy or Kerbal Space Academy as well on Twitch. Awesome footage, Dos. You nailed it. Okay, so now it's time to actually talk about what went wrong. And luckily, almost immediately, we got the answers from Mr. Elon Musk himself. The grid fin hydraulic pump stalled, so Falcon landed just out to sea. It appears to be undamaged and is transmitting data. Recovery ship dispatched. And then he then doubled down saying the cutaway was a mistake. We will show all footage, good or bad, which they have now. Then they said, we may use this booster for an internal mission because someone asked, could it still be reused? And he said, yes, yes, it probably could still be reused for an internal SpaceX mission, which is crazy. SpaceX apparently is getting a lot more comfortable with reusing things that are in the ocean, as Elon casually mentioned that they're maybe going to reuse a fairing that they recovered from the ocean recently, just 2 days ago. Then, now here's the deeper explanation here. So the pump is single string. Some landing systems are not redundant, as landing is considered ground safety critical, but not mission critical. So then he says, given this event, we will likely add a backup pump and lines. So here's what he's talking about here. So previously, the grid fins used to be on what's called an open loop system. And that's where the hydraulic fluid, which is helium, is pushed through the actuators that control the grid fins, and then it's bled out into the atmosphere. So it's wasted. After the CRS-5, SpaceX changed to a closed loop system because they had a failure when it completely ran out of hydraulic fluid. And then they closed it and made it into a circulating pump. Now he's saying that this is single string, meaning there's a single pump and that feeds all four grid fins. And now he's saying apparently that they're going to just make it all redundant and add another pump and add another set of lines so that it has some redundancy here. And this is where we have the conclusion. This is why failures are actually important, because someday SpaceX is hoping to land propulsively with humans on board for their Starship. It's only a failure if you don't learn anything from it. So here we are. This is a perfect engineering opportunity to take a failure and learn something from it and make a better rocket. And the important things here are, guys, this was not at risk of falling on anyone's house or head or car or dog. They purposefully missed the landing zone at Cape Canaveral by a decent amount. And then the grid fins are there to actually steer it that last little bit and dogleg over onto the landing pad. So no one was at any risk here. That's an important thing to note. So there's no humans involved. There's no safety things. This vehicle flies itself. It's all autonomous. And it did an amazing job almost recovering. You can tell it begins to stabilize its spin and does an incredible job of landing softly despite having a pretty massive failure like this. That just goes to show how robust these systems are, and the fact that it didn't just totally go crashing out of control or do anything crazy. It landed right where it's supposed to, considering the circumstances, which is safely in the ocean where no one is at the time. And do note that, of course, any rocket launch, there's a whole exclusion zone. So if someone's even kayaking nearby, they will scrub the launch. So you don't need to worry about people's lives at risk here. This is totally all accounted for. Although this was a failure, it's a good failure. People are going to learn from this. SpaceX engineers are going to learn from this, make a better Falcon 9 rocket. And the mission, of course, the important part is the mission was still completely successful. And if this was 3 years ago today, SpaceX or any other company would have been throwing away these boosters. So just to keep that in context, 3 years ago today, no one had ever landed propulsively the first stage of a liquid-fueled orbital-class rocket. On Monday, they reused a booster for the second time reusing it, making it the third time it's flown. So don't forget, just a few days ago, we were celebrating how awesome they're doing at this reuse thing. So just remember today's flight. It unfortunately was a brand new booster. It had never flown before. But hopefully we'll see it fly again, potentially, which would just be crazy. This will be one to watch. This booster's name is 1050.1. If you need to know more about that, you can kind of keep track. I let you know which booster core it is that flies on my website. So go to pre-launch previews on my website, everydayastronaut.com/pre-launch previews. And you'll be able to keep track of which booster is flying. So just kind of remember that in your head. If you see 1050 next, if it flies again, it'd be .2. Remember, this one had a little swim, it's just crazy. I really hope it does get a fly again. That'd be awesome. So that's what happened. Again, don't take this out of context. Yes, it was a landing failure, but everyone was safe. It performed phenomenally despite the failure. The mission was still a success. And again, SpaceX will just learn from this and make a better, more robust system. Thanks, everybody. That's going to do it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.